like I struck gold. I unzipped the baggie, I poured all over my desk, and like staring at my cocaine kingdom like I'm Scarface. I just want to go, ooh. I do some. Cocaine has long stopped making me feel good. The high that I have originally received that made me feel like I was loved and accepted and made me feel like I was somebody, but that it was a false feeling. I panicked. What did I just do? I have enough cocaine to go away for a fairly long time, right? So I put it all back in the Ziploc baggies, I hide it, I get in my car, and I drive up to Home Depot. I go into Home Depot, I buy electrical outlet faceplates, a drill and a saw. I come back to my place, I go to each closet in my house, I drill a fake electrical outlet in each closet. And I take all the cocaine and I put it in these little Ziploc baggies and I hide it behind all these fake electrical outlets. Like the cops, the DEA, and the drug dogs have never thought of that one before. I do a little more. Only shame, guilt. The guilt of what I had done. The guilt of knowing that I have this issue that I don't know how to get myself out of. I am addicted. I am an addict. Back to each electrical outlet. Pull all the cocaine back in the Ziploc baggie. I run upstairs to my toilet and I flush it all down the toilet. $1,000 in cocaine. Well, a little less since I dumped some. The next morning comes. What did I just do? I had all this cocaine and I flushed it all down the toilet. As often happens, the shame and the pain and the fear were in the rearview mirror. The next morning, I am such an idiot. Another call to my drug dealer. Two more tickets. He shows up. Make the trade. Do a little. Nothing. Shame, pain. Put it back in the electrical outlets. Panic. Paranoia. Who here has seen Christmas Vacation? I think the SWAT team's about to come through my windows like the SWAT team at Christmas Vacation. Back to the electrical outlets. Take it all out again. Put it back in the Ziploc baggie. Back up to the toilet. Drop to my knees like I have done so many times, hoping and wishing for someone or something to take the pain of my addiction away, take my cravings away, and flush it all down the toilet again. They say when Dallas flushes, it ends up in Houston, so some people in Houston go pretty high that night. That was my life as an addict. That was my life as an alcoholic. That was, pardon the pun, the life of Brian. How did I get that way? How did I go from a young, shy teenage boy born in Pittsburgh, PA, to someone who was so horrified of his reflection, someone who was so despondent that he would never be loved, that he would never love himself, that he would never find love. He saw this monster every time he looked in the mirror, then he decided to end his own life. Well, we have to go back to Pittsburgh, PA. I'm in the middle of three children. You all know, obviously, my older brother, Mark. I have a younger brother, Jeff. Mark, as you might guess, as the firstborn, was the outgoing one. He was a Shark Tank guy from day one. Back in the early 70s, our local paper in Pittsburgh went on strike. He was barely old enough to drive. He drove with a bunch of his buddies to Cleveland, bought the Cleveland newspaper. They drove back and sold it on the street corner of Pittsburgh. He was doing deals at 15 years old. You knew what he was going to be, and he became that and a little bit more. My younger brother, Jeff, was a jock, a wrestler, ladies' man, beer parties, dates, having a good time, kind of a wild child. I was classic middle child syndrome. I was very shy. I was very reserved. Can't tell standing up here, but when you're passionate, you're not quite as reserved. I also internalized everything that was said about me and to me, especially the negative things. Classic middle child syndrome. Unfortunately, I also had a very difficult relationship with my mom, and I'll tell you a little bit about that because it's important, but I need to make it clear. I do not blame my parents. I do not blame my mother. Parents do not cause eating disorders. Parents do not cause addiction. This is just part of the environment. It can be triggers, and it's part of how things went. But it's an important environmental aspect of my journey. There was a lot of fat shaming in my household. My mom would come home in the 70s from selling real estate, and she would see me eating Chef Boyardee out of the can. Do they still have that? I would eat it out of the can. I love to eat it out of the can. And she would say to me, Brian, if you keep eating like that, you're going to be a fat pig. These were the things her mother said to her. And these were the things our grandmother said to our mother. This type of thing is often generational in nature. And if I came home with bad grades, she would say, as her mother says to her, you're a dumb bunny. So, as you might imagine, even though it wasn't her fault and she was repeating cycles, as a young tween-age boy, I grew depressed at hearing these things. And I ate more Chef Boyardee ravioli and more Chef Boyardee ravioli. And as happens when you eat more and more, I grew to be a bigger Brian and a bigger Brian and a chubbier Brian. And a quote-unquote, I hate the word, but it's used in bullying and it was used against me, fat Brian. And as what often happens when people change what is perceived for the negative, the bullying started at school. The fat jokes, the fat teasing. And it all culminated one day in what I call the day of the gold pants. Who here has seen Saturday Night Fever? I see some hands go up there. So my brother Mark, believe it or not, used to teach disco. Are we being filmed? He had this pair of shiny satin gold bell-bottom disco pants. And yes, he wore them. One day he shows up in my bedroom and he goes, hey bro, he still calls me that today. I'm getting a new pair of pants. Would you like these pants? I said, sure, I love my brother. We're very close. He gave me something that showed me a symbol of his love. And I said, I'll take those pants. But Mark wasn't a big guy. Those pants fit Mark fine. They didn't fit me very well. My butt looked like 15 cats back there. You know, I had to jump up and down, spray the water bottle on. But I got those pants on, and I wore them to school. Yes, I did. I waddled around that school trying not to rip those pants. And as you might have guessed, the kids made fun of me. And it all culminated one day while I'm walking home with these kids. These kids were bullies, but I tried to hang around the bullies because they were also, in my mind, the popular group. This was before Al Gore invented the internet, right? This was pre-digital. I didn't have these digital images that I worshiped, the unattainable. My images were the people I saw every day. The prom king, the prom queen, the people who were going to the dances, the people who were going on their first date, having their first kiss. I wanted that so bad. So I hung around these kids while they bullied me. And we're walking home from school about a mile from my house in Pittsburgh, PA, and one of them goes, Brian, those pants just look bad on you. I think we need to take them off you. And before I knew it, these three boys had physically assaulted me, tore my shiny gold bell-bottom disco pants off, a mile from home, tore them into shreds and threw them in the street down my Through the Loom Tidy Whities. That event was so traumatic, I can go to that spot in Pittsburgh, PA, and show you exactly where it happened, all these decades later. So I waddle on home, cover up my privates, no one stops, everyone gawks. I get home, I'm ashamed, I put them in the bottom of the basket, no one ever says a word. But in my mind, they had validated everything my mom had said to me. I was a dumb bunny and a fat pig who couldn't stand up to himself for bullies. And it was right around then that I really started to look in the mirror and see just this horrible, horrible, unloved monster. And I went on to Penn State University. And I'm going to tell you about a little incident at Penn State. Not everything that's happened to me is bad, so, you know, if you need to take a drink or do some yoga. It's a tough story to hear, but I'm standing up here, so it's as a happy ending. I jumped. So I'm staring out the window of Penn State University, this long rectangular window, a beautiful fall day. I make eye contact with, as I remember it 30 years ago, 40 years ago, this brown hair, curly, beautiful young lady. She's talking to her friends, we make eye contact, I start sweating. I'm someone who's never kissed a girl, never held a girl's hand, never went to the prom. And I'm thinking, oh wow, this girl likes me. And I start thinking, within like 10 seconds, I've envisioned dating this girl, marrying this girl, we're going to have 2 and 1/2 children. Forget the bullies. I'm good. I am good for the next 4 years. It wasn't a smile. It was a smirk. She turns back, puts her hands over her mouth just like this, and goes, ugly, ugly. I am not the first young man to have nasty things said about him. There are people in this room who have been through a lot worse than that. But everyone responds to their environment differently. I was somebody who already had a terrible self-image. I was somebody who already thought he was ugly, was afraid to even look in the mirror to see that he was ugly. I didn't think he would ever be loved by his mother or anyone. And it was right then that I decided my entire life was out of control. What did I have control over? I had control over food. I didn't want to eat more, so I began restricting myself. And before I knew it, as a 19-year-old at Penn State University in 1979, I had descended into anorexia. And later that same year, transitioned into bulimia, which is the act of binging and purging. Yes, guys do get eating disorders. 30% of all those with eating disorders are men. Males. I did not go into recovery for my eating disorder until 2007. And then I turned 22, or 21, Pittsburgh.